Welcome back. This is Damian David with Healthcare Triangle. And this is my week in review. This is week number 17, Monday, August 3rd, 2020. I'm going to give you some headlines in the world of coronavirus and COVID-19 around the world. I'm going to jump to a conversation and check in with my colleague, Kate Corbett. Earlier this week, she posted a blog on healthcaretriangle.com. Some valuable resources around the information blocking rules out there. And also HL7 fire APIs. Really good resources. I got the link in the body and in the description of this video, this week in review for you. So you can go ahead and check it out after you check out Kate's interview. And then I'm going to leave you with some good music. It's one of my favorite songs. I used to do it all the time when I was growing up. Great song. Hope you enjoy it. Leave you with some good images from around the world in this COVID-19 coronavirus times as well. All right, so stay energized. Appreciate what you're doing for the healthcare community. Keep it up. Keep up the good fight. We need the energy. Next week, kids start going back to school, and man, let's keep that diligence going. All right, let's hop to the headlines. Today on CNN, Mayra Ramirez, the 28-year-old who had coronavirus COVID-19, spoke with Christina Maxouris and the cardiothoracic surgeon that gave her a double lung transplant at Northwestern Memorial Hospital today. So she's recovering nicely. She discusses and she tells the tale of what she went through over the 6 months of recovery from coronavirus COVID-19 and also recovering from the first one-of-a-kind surgery in the world. So amazing. Love to see her on the news. Please, if you want to just search for her, Mayra Ramirez, double lung transplant. That's a feel-good moment. It's worth checking out today if you got some time. In Kosovo, the Prime Minister, Avdullah Hoti, has tested positive for COVID-19. So yet another world leader has tested positive for COVID-19. Back in the U.S., Congress is continuing negotiations on the next emergency aid package after the last one lapsed last week. Okay, so they're getting it together. Trump is actually putting some pressure on Congress, trying to force his hand, if you will. I don't know, it's just a power play, just conversation, but they should be figuring something out relatively soon, I hope, for some of the folks that could use stimulus. Storms. Big storm Isaiah hits the Atlantic coast, making shelters struggle to screen for COVID-19 as people come in to shelter from the storm. Just another challenge that COVID-19 is actually presenting itself. The storm is also putting on a bunch of tornado watches in the Northeast. So picked up some steam and is presenting in the Northeast as tornadoes. Okay, schools, I mentioned next week we're going back. And schools are still quite divided over, are they going to be in-person instruction in the classroom or are they going to be remote learning? Some of them are going to be a hybrid model. It's going to have both, maybe a couple days in, a couple days out. It's going to be interesting to see. Some schools are going back as early as next week. I don't know that everybody has a firm plan that can't be changed last minute. So it'll be interesting to see what plans go into effect as early as next week, okay? Again, hopefully your family stays safe. I want the teachers to know that I'm thinking about them as much as I'm thinking about our healthcare professionals. They will be on the front lines come next week themselves. So keep up the good fight and keep up the diligence around being safe, okay? United Nations, they're actually calling on policymakers to plan thoroughly for reopening of schools. And the reason is because saying that this could actually lead to a generational catastrophe if they don't do it right and they don't plan appropriately for the reopening of schools. Compelling argument. In the U.S., two-thirds of us Americans, we feel that the U.S. is handling the pandemic worse than other countries out there. So super critical of our own country yet again. But, you know, there's something to be said about that. I think we have an opportunity here. If we don't think we're handling the pandemic that well, let's make some changes and make sure that we get better at it. And let's start with ourselves. Wear those masks. Be diligent. Be safe. All right, let's get the stats this week. Every week I do stats around the world and then within the U.S. First, confirmed cases at the world and the U.S. level, then the recoveries, and then the deaths. So let's start with the world. Confirmed cases are up to 18 million now. Last week they were sitting at 16.3 million. Now, 10.7 million people around the world have recovered from COVID-19. Last week we were sitting at a total of 9.43 million. And this week we're up to 689,000 COVID-19 related deaths around the world. Last week we were sitting at 650,000 total. In the U.S., 4.77 million confirmed cases. whereas last week we were only at 4.33 million. Of those, 2.32 million have recovered, where last week we were only at 1.3 million. So we've had another million in just the past week alone actually recovered from COVID-19. So some good progress as far as recoveries are going. Hopefully that continues to trend in that manner. And then deaths are up to the total of 157,000 deaths in the U.S., whereas last week we were up to 149,000. Well, there you have it. Those are our headlines. I'm excited to have another conversation with Kate Corbett. I think this is going to be some valuable resources for you folks. Please take the time, check it out, make sure that you're configured appropriately. You got everything set up and in place for these information blocking roles to make sure that you know, you're doing it the right way. You're not going to run into any problems in the future. I think as early as November, the reporting comes into effect. So again, if you need any help, please reach out to Kate. I've left her information in the description on how to contact her and get in connection with her on LinkedIn. Also, please reach out to me if you have any questions. Happy to forward you information I can or connect you with Kate so that you can get help with it. All right. Without further ado, let's jump to the conversation I had earlier with my colleague, Kate Corbett. Kate Corbett, good to see you again. Thanks for getting on the call here with me. So I noticed you posted a blog, and I wanted to actually share that with all of our viewers a little bit, you know, give a little bit of a highlight of what it is. I think it's pretty timely. I think it's a good time for folks to kind of concentrate on it, and I want to make sure that they, A, understand where it is, and then B, understand how to quickly get it. So I'm going to put it in the description of the week in review this year so they can just click the link. And then I'm going to flash up what it looks like too as we talk about it so that way they can't miss it. But yeah, give us a little bit of a taste of what you've been working on.
Yeah, absolutely, Damian. So I'm really excited to share a new healthcaretriangle.com blog post about new ONC and CMS interoperability rules, specifically focused on what people are calling information blocking rules. These rules came out in March, although enforcement is beginning coming in November. So it's a really good opportunity for folks to take a look at their compliance with these rules. There are a couple of things that the rules say you must do. One of those things is that you have got to adopt these standard application programming interfaces, otherwise called APIs. The standard for those APIs is HL7 FHIR. Those APIs will allow individuals to securely access their data and integrate it with third-party applications. So healthcare organizations have to make sure that their EHRs are up to date and that they've adopted these APIs. The other thing they have to do is to be sure that patients can electronically access all of what is their electronic health information. Their electronic health information includes a new standard from these ONC and CMS called the US Core Data for Interoperability Standard. So there's new data elements that are required to be shared electronically. These should be some fairly straightforward updates from a technology perspective, EHR reconfiguration, connect with your vendor to make sure that they're making these available to you timely, but that generally occurs with a certified EHR. There are some pieces and parts of this that are a little more complicated, especially from an operational perspective, and I'd like to tell you a little bit more about those if that's okay.
Sure, yeah, please do.
Great. So one of the things that's different about this particular rule is that providers are prohibited from using practices that might interfere with, prohibit, or discourage patients from accessing or sharing their electronic health information. So the idea that implementing the APIs and making a few new data elements available on the patient portal might not be enough to comply with that rule, and it's definitely not enough to comply with the spirit of that rule. So what we're providing on the blog are some recommendations for how to really take this opportunity to be compliant, but also to leverage sharing of new data in new ways to improve patient engagement and also to drive innovation in your organization. So we give you a basic framework for what do I need to have in place to be ready for these new information blocking rules? How do I use the tools that I'm going to use for sharing of electronic health information and begin to build more and more robust patient engagement tools? So first we talked about comply with that HL7 FHIR API standard. Also, we recommend optimizing your patient portal features. So if there are ways that you can release information to patients and allow them to share it with a provider of their choosing, make sure those things are turned on. Also, if you don't yet have electronic consents for patients to share data, while that is part of the application programming interfaces, that you also want to make sure that patients have other ways to electronically consent to data sharing. We talked a second ago about the U.S. standards for core data interoperability. Those are the data elements that need to be enabled for sharing. So those, that again, should be fairly straightforward EHR reconfiguration, except there's the need to educate your organization about the expanded data that's available for patients. That includes more timely release of results. Some organizations have historically delayed results release. This is a good opportunity to take a look and make sure you're doing that with a quick turnaround. Also, the new data standards require you to provide notes to patients electronically. The Open Notes Initiative has been around for a few years now. Some organizations are ahead of the curve and already have those available, but for others, this will be completely new. And educating your providers about the fact that patients can now read those descriptive summaries of their care is very important. Scanned documents are another area that we recommend making sure is available to patients through some electronic means. That's something that we see historically. Sometimes organizations have blocked from being available to patients through the existing patient portal. So you're going to want to work through how you can free up as much of that information as possible to be shared with patients. And you'll need to look at operational workflows around data sharing. How do you manage more complex consents? Who can provide permissions to share information electronically? Who deals with questions from patients about how to share their data electronically or helps them when they have a problem? This brings up new questions again about patient proxy access. That's been a tricky issue for organizations for many years that varies by state. So there are operational workflows to look at as well. But we, you know, I really would encourage folks to visit the blog. It gives you a really good basic overview of what we'd recommend to be compliant with the new rules and some food for thought about things you can do that are really moving in a better direction around patient engagement and innovation.
Awesome. Excellent resource. Again, I'm going to put the link to it in the description of the Week in Review. Yeah, definitely valuable resource here. I can't believe it. HL7's all grown up, huh? We're finally the API. I think I told somebody about 8-9 years ago that I see it transitioning over to API, and everybody thought it was crazy. So glad to see it actually come to fruition. All right, hot seat time. You ready for it?
I'm ready, Damian.
Right, this is one that I like and I think about all the time. What's been your favorite summer beverage during COVID-19 coronavirus? One for the workday? And one for after the workday.
Oh gosh. Okay. So for during the workday, I've actually been enjoying a really fun cold brew iced tea with cucumber and mint. So you just put the tea bag in some ice cold water and you get this very refreshing tea. Let's see, after work beverage, I have a plan for this upcoming week, I will say, to make some homemade watermelon margaritas from scratch. Take a little of that watermelon that's overripe that you didn't quite finish, throw it in the blender with lime, tequila. You don't even need too much ice, and it's a 3-minute, fruity, refreshing fun time.
That sounds wonderful. Yeah, mine are easy. I got, I don't know, yours sounds refreshing, but I just have iced coffee from the mill. It's local here in Lincoln, Nebraska. And then I've been on those hard seltzer. I've been on a kick for that. I don't know why. Something light and easy, I think, for the summer.
Yeah, definitely.
But hey, good to talk to you. Nice to see you. And thanks for sharing. Appreciate it. Take care and hopefully see you soon.
Thanks. You too, Damian.
Thanks again to Kate Corbett. Always a pleasure to talk to her. I'm going to try that watermelon drink, I think. It sounds pretty good. A little bit later here. Maybe another 20 minutes. Hey, have a good week. I hope you like this next song. Keep up the good fight. Hope you're energized. Hope you're feeling good. Hope you're being safe. Hope your family's healthy and safe. Take care.
Crossroads seem to come and go. Yeah, yeah. Just it flies from coast to coast. Known many loving none. A barren sorrow and having fun. Just won't stay.